that in the stream title. Okay. Oh, gotta move the mic. Forgive me. One second. Sorry for the ad hoc nature of this. I was just notified an instant ago that this match started. So, they concluded one game. I should start this by saying mastertan, rated 2688, is one of the strongest Crazy House chess players on LeeChess.org, if not in the world. He's had numerous strong performances in numerous online arenas. Clearly, with both based on his rating and his activity in not only playing against other players, but just commenting in forums and participating and, I assume to some extent, training people to play better and discussing new ideas. Unfortunately, I don't know all the details, but no, for sure, he's one of the strongest authorities on the game. So here we are. I promise I didn't request this opening, although it is fairly common in this variant. I should say that mastertan is playing a match against Stockfish, who Vinvin has graciously volunteered to operate. And I apparently have volunteered to commentate on as of a minute ago. Not yet notified anybody of this, but hey, let's have fun with it, right? Let me check this isn't going first. Okay, yeah, I do have the video feed. That's awesome. Let me dismiss any windows I don't need to have open. Then secondarily, let me ensure that my browser doesn't close in the middle of this. There we go. So now this, in the terms of this match, are going to be unrated games, because you're not allowed to play rated. You can't play rated with assistance on this site. However, if both players consent, you can play an unrated game with assistance, and that's what's being done here. Vinvin is relaying the moves to some sort of computer that's really beefed up and set up well to play in this kind of match condition. So this is more strong than AI level 8. This is basically Stockfish at its full power, playing against one of the strongest players on the site. So, exciting stuff. This opening is pretty common, at least in my experience. I've seen a lot of human players play this bishop c4 and even bishop c5. I've played bishop c5 on many occasions and gotten my rear end handed to me most of these occasions. So usually I don't play so ambitiously. But, note that even here, Stockfish retreated the bishop to e7 after moving it to c5. It's just a bit of a target there, and unless you have some really interesting counterattacking chances, it's a bit of a risk, to be honest. So I don't know how many games we're going to go for. I guess until the players get exhausted or until one of them has to go. But no, it's a fun exhibition, and I'm glad to just provide what insight I can provide on this. Queen c8. Is he really threatening to trade bishop for two pawns? He might be. In Bughouse, I've seen a piece sacked even for a single pawn in that section of the board. One thing that's worth noting about Crazy House is that if you sacrifice a piece, you're not down one piece, you're down two pieces. And so, sure, attacking chances on the king are important, but material does count too. Hey, Mr. Corrupted. Welcome. Yeah, sorry, I've been a little bit inactive lately. So, yeah, I'm really unsure about most of what's going on in this game. So, white is rated 2688. Black is essentially Stockfish, which has a pretty high rating. I don't know exactly what, but it doesn't matter. And here I am on this site. I've got a rating of 2150, so my ability to comment on anything beyond generalities is kind of limited. Hey Zug, welcome. So yeah, I've for sure played a ton of Crazy House and Bug House, but that doesn't make me necessarily qualified to talk about what's going on in a particular position. We'll get to that in a minute. I do want to comment on a couple general remarks here first. So, like, here, if this were Bug House, White would just say, "Get me a couple more pawns," to his partner. The partner would give him a pawn, and he'd like be plunking them on e6 and g6 and f7, and this would be a massacre. But because this is Crazy House chess, getting the pieces that you need in hand can be kind of challenging. Okay, so there's interest in what I had going yesterday. Sorry to hear that. So, yeah, yesterday I did. I've managed to figure out how to install an AI to play the game Dungeon Crawl Stone Soup. Yeah, there's a bot that plays the game. It has successfully won the game under some parameters. I'm still learning a bit about it, but I was just glad to be able to write, or not write, but execute it. And the one thing I contributed to that, not that I made the AI because I didn't, not that I made the game because I didn't make that either, but I did make it look nice on stream, by slowing it down enough that people could watch it and appreciate it. So yeah, I'll do that again at some point. It'll be fun. So let's see. Black has four diagonal moving pieces in hand. Black does not have a knight in hand. Black does not have a queen in hand or a rook. So still, it's going to be a bit tricky for Black to land some pieces, say on h2 or e3 or g3. He still needs more pieces in that area to support an attack. Got to admit, e6 was not the first square I was looking at there. I was really thinking pawn f4 was going to happen. But unless White gets some pawns in hand, it's going to be difficult to push around Black's pieces. I don't know. I don't really don't know too much about it. The AI is called WQ. I'm sorry, QW. So look it up, and if you want to, make improvements to it, and I'll try running it, and we'll see who can make the best improvements. Yeah, Vinvin's relaying the matches between, or the moves between the Lee Chess interface and something he's got on his computer that allows Stockfish to run. So this way, the AI is able to spend more time thinking about moves. At some point, I do want to better automate that sort of play. And given the policy that Lee Chess has at the moment, such automation might have to happen outside of Lee Chess, but that's okay. I was wondering, why did Black move his knight from g6 to f4? Because I was looking away, reading the window. I'm misspeaking a lot. I meant to say, why did black move from g6 to f4 if that's not what I said? But no, black placed the knight on f4, which is quite different. If he had a knight somewhere in the vicinity, placing an additional piece would be the strongest move. Turns out he didn't really have a piece around that section of the board, so he had to add one. I keep saying he, but really black is it, Stockfish, playing without any kind of reservation. Yeah, crazy house tactics are pretty wild. And I'm working on trying to address as many open issues as possible, just to make the AI, I don't know, something we can all be proud of. It already does quite well. I don't quite understand what happened there. Because to me, it looked like pawn takes f1 check was definitely possible. So I'm not sure why there was an exchange, why black took on f4 rather than taking f1. Unless that's to say that black's position is already so strong that it doesn't matter which move it selects. But I'd much rather, the human instinct would be to take on f1 right away and resolve the tension. But maybe that pawn on e2 supports some kind of mating attack. So how does white guard the h2 square? Or does white take on g3, black recaptures and has a pawn in hand? Or, yeah, maybe. Oh, I missed that. That's a really important detail. Yeah, because now if bishop takes, you can check on h2 and possibly push through the pawn somehow. I'm maybe not seeing all the details, but if that bishop weren't on h3, then g2 check would be devastating because black would get an additional queen and then skewer the rook on a1 and. Yeah. Well, it's maybe control of f1 is worth more than giving up a pawn for a rook, because pawns are actually worth something in this game. Not to say that they're worthless in chess, but pawns are very useful for pushing around pieces. Here we see that white has quite a few pawns around the king. Although I thought black was the one who sacked a bishop for two pawns, so what's going on here? Not necessarily that trading a bishop for two is a sack, but that's what I thought had happened. So queen g1 mates the threat, everybody sees it, but what do you do about it? Oh, you resign. Okay. I don't claim to understand that. Now, as I mentioned earlier, the conditions of this match are that Vin Vin and Stockfish will take black every game. Apparently, that's just the conditions that the players agreed to, and that can make things kind of fun. There's nothing that says that the match has to be balanced color-wise. And it's definitely fun playing as the white pieces in this variant. And it's not so fun defending. I know I'm not rated the same as these players. I'm outrated by over 500 points here, but I would give a plus one, like a one pawn advantage, to white, just because the initiative's kind of huge. It's a lot easier to attack and drum up an initiative as white against strong opponents or opposition, at least in my experience. So yeah, if people have questions about Crazy House, I'll attempt to answer. So if this were Bug House, the obvious thing that'd be going on here would be white's threatening pawn at e5. And of course, black is going to respond to that threat. And I guess the only thing black had to decide there was which way to respond to it. Like, which piece do you either move to or place on e7 to break the pin? Note, queen d6 ran into pawn placed at e5, forking the queen and the knight. But yeah, how do you develop? I always find this tricky against a strong opponent. Is like, if I put my bishop on d3, black just plunks the pawn on e4, and that's that. So often you'll see me playing moves like h3 and knight f3, although that's kind of a waste of a tempo. But how do you do something more economical? Oh, pawn at h6, that's a thematic idea. I assume that there was something planned against that, but I don't know what. Maybe black just lets it happen. Probably if pawn at h6, one thing that works in Bughouse sometimes is black just plays rook g8 and activates the rook on the g-file. That probably works better in Bughouse than it does in Crazy House. Because in Crazy House, you're always going to have at least 20-some pieces on the board. So you really can't afford to leave so many holes around your king. So now the queen at e2 is a bit awkward. So yeah, maybe pawn at h6 earlier would have been strong. Or maybe black just plays g7, g6, and doesn't worry about the hole. And just assumes that white never gets a rook or a queen to drop on g7. So I was doing some tuning of the AI the other day, just trying to figure out how much are each piece worth. And in that tuning, it appeared that, well, we already know that knights are... I'm sorry, I'm getting confused. I'm running so many tests with the Stockfish AI that I'm forgetting which tests I ran in which sequence. I was about to say something about King of the Hill chess, which does not really apply to Crazy House. In my experience, knights are really strong in this. Rooks are also very strong. Obviously, a queen is good, although it's not able to push around two pieces as easily as a queen could push around two pieces in normal chess. Guessing white hopes that black misevaluates how much a queen is worth. You know, I forgot to get before this game what the material values are. I don't know, we could leave that a bit of a mystery, where people could try to guess what they are. The answers are, in fact, published online on GitHub. Just the way we've been publishing, distributing, and sharing, and merging, and improving the source code is through that repository. So the current values of the pieces are there. But that's not to say that they'll always be those values. It could always change. I mean, if you want the most modular sort of chess variant, that would be cool. I think the chess variant site made some attempt. No. So there's the chess variants index. You can search your favorite search engine. You can find, I think it's called the chess variants index or the chess variant pages. But they have an index of all the variants. And somewhere therein lies an engine that is infinitely flexible and ultimately not that strong. But it's able to play quite a few variants. So. There's some trade-off there, and that if you're not going for the most optimal thing, you can achieve quite a bit. Yeah. Well, see, if you get weird variants like that, then what happens if you lose your king? There really isn't much potential for three check in a game where you may or may not have a king. Yeah, at a minimum, it'd be kind of fun to shuffle like 960 style the start position on many of these and see what happens. That I could see being done. Some of the other things, at some point my engine was actually capable of playing these hybrid variants. I'm not claiming that it fully supported everything, but you could combine all the win conditions and eventually, I got so much negative feedback about the idea, and it got in the way of actual development that I had to scrap it. But yeah, it was fun for a time. Three check racing kings, the game where you can't check your opponent. That would be awesome. So, yeah, I guess mastertan was as surprised by Knight takes e3 as I was, which surprises me quite a bit. I haven't been doing much specific commentary on that move because I'm like, well, surely mastertan saw this. And even though I have no idea what's going on, surely he must grasp this. I apparently. This is complicated. So. Yeah, so he could have taken the exchange. Or, I'm sorry, it could have. Traded knight for rook. But better still was taking and getting the pawn in hand. Because that's one less pawn defending the king and one more pawn to attack with. So trading a knight for a rook in this kind of position wasn't worth it. So now the next thing that logically occurs to me would be black playing like pawn at e4 and then pawn at d3. And trying to cage in White's king. I could be completely off, and there could be something far better here. But that would be my reaction, is that I want to start placing pawns near my opponent's king and see maybe after I place all that, I could get enough knights and rooks in hand to do something dangerous. Okay. So, I didn't see at all that the pawn on d4 was hanging. But, yeah, it looks like black has grabbed three pawns, but will black ever place them on the board? Stay tuned for next episode. Yeah. Not just a lot of engineering, but a lot of testing specifically. All right, you heard it from the master. This is so lost. Yeah, no, I really don't see what white's doing. So I guess black is just dawdling, taking its time. and playing some pretty efficient moves. Yeah, no, this does look quite terrible for White because White hasn't made a single dent on Black's king side. I mean, the closest thing to a dent here is either the pawn on e5 or the bishop threatening d8. So, to me, the obvious idea is just bishop takes d8, but White doesn't have a knight in hand. If White had a knight in hand, then maybe there'd be some attacking chances after you have the queen in hand too. Maybe. Another thing that could be fun if that knight were not on f5 would just be placing the pawn on e7, forking the queen and the rook and threatening to promote, and then after promoting, placing another pawn on e7. But that knight on f5 ruins all of white's fun. So, I'm guessing that Stockfish did not walk into this without having some kind of attack planned after this. And having a knight and a queen in hand is pretty terrifying. So, I'm not liking white's chances. But you'd be amazed what some players could defend. Because it's not like black can just plunk the queen anywhere. Black has to attack in a pretty methodical manner for anything positive to come of this. Checkmating can be kind of tricky against a strong player, such as mastertan. Now, while many human players do crumble quite quickly in these sort of position, you'd be surprised how resilient some of the strongest players are. So, I mean, sure, black's got three pieces and two pawns in hand, but what does black do? White has plenty of defenders locally right around his king. So black needs to find a way to increase the pressure. I guess that suffices, because if white were to block on d2, black could either capture on d2 or do queen takes d3 next. And then taking on d3, you'd be threatening queen c2 mate, and also knight at e2 mate. So, yeah, here I am just commentating on an impromptu, I want to say impromptu, I don't know if this was planned or not, but a match between mastertan, one of Lee Chess's strongest Crazy House players, and Stockfish, being operated by VinVin. This is an unrated game, so this is perfectly legit and legal. This does not violate any rule. And both players are happy to play and participate in this challenge. And I figured it was a damn shame nobody was commentating on it, or at least now nobody that I knew of was. Possibly somebody is, I just don't know about it. So I took this opportunity to say, you know what, I can commentate on that. Let's do it. So, we got a center counter. Normally, I just push e5. I'm not sure why you'd exchange. That space advantage after e5 is really comfortable. It seems confusing to me that you would exchange into this, but mastertan must know more than I. I'm not sure if it shows below the board, but so far the score is 3-0. In the games that I've observed, it's been 2-0, but they played a game before I started commentating. You know, I'm not sure exactly how he does it. I assume he just picks the top move. I'm not sure exactly how and when he selects that top move. And to that end, I do want to automate play of this AI so that it can play at these time controls. And make the best use of its time. And I assume what's happening is that VinVin just looks and sees whenever he feels like that Stockfish has come up with the best move, and he just plays it. I assume he's manually budgeting Stockfish's time, which is a fun challenge in itself. But no, I do want to see if I can at some point automate some of that process, so not to be such a burden on VinVin. He's put in a lot of work making these matches, most of them with Jan Lee, the player who just, the Lee Chess Master, who yesterday won the yearly yearly Crazy House Arena. I think there were 900 some players participating in that arena. And yeah, out of that 900 some players, let's see. Yeah, Jan Lee took first place, upsetting an international master, Opervasen, and upsetting another player who late joined the tournament, who I think was named 12 Teen. I don't know anything about him, but he seemed to go berserk every game and won like 95% of his games, but wasn't winning enough in order to win the tournament outright. Just pretty funny. It was quite a valiant effort, but had he just won one more match or one more game, that might have been the difference. So, yeah, I don't like White's position, to be honest. Again, you see that White has only one piece on Black's side of the board. Arguably, Black doesn't have any pieces on White's side of the board at the moment, but it's Black's move. Yeah, no, I would do D takes and castle and get the heck out of there, because you know you're not going to castle kingside. At least I wouldn't. But yeah, I think given Vinvin's rating, I mean, he's quite experienced at the game. He enjoys it quite a bit. But given the disparity between Vinvin and Stockfish's ratings, I'm guessing that Vinvin is just simply relaying the moves and not trying to select from among Stockfish's favorite moves here. I think in previous matches, Vinvin said that the first few moves were played through an opening book, usually about four or five moves. I don't know if that same condition applies to this match or not. So, I think I've said everything I know, unless people want to ask questions and perhaps I know more, but I think that's the extent of my knowledge. It's too bad that knight on c6 is pinned, or we might see something like knight e5. Just taking advantage of that pin against the queen. Oh, I'm sorry. If bishop moves from c1 to e3, black just plays pawn at f4. Perhaps even knight at f4, but yeah, what else can white do here? White could play pawn at e3. White could play pawn at e2. I wouldn't retreat the bishop, but white could do that. It would walk into knight at f4, except that bishop would take on f4. But I don't like retreating with the bishop because it unpins the knight. I'd probably cowardly play pawn at e2, recognizing that c2 is lost. But perhaps white can get away with king d1. Probably not. No, if king d1, queen d5. So it looks like c2 is lost. Oh. Or maybe not. Maybe I don't know what I'm talking about. Maybe queen d5 and white has some kind of crazy counter-attacking move going on here. Oh. What? Why this move? Oh, why not knight h4? What's going on? I guess if knight h4, black trades queens, then plays queen at d5, and oh, then collects the rook on d1. No. Then collects the knight on g2, threatening the rook on h1. So, so yeah, white's forced to exchange a knight for a pawn. But that means white has another pawn to fortify his king's defenses. Might not matter so much here, because I'm guessing queen d5 follows. As after queen d5, the bishop's attacked, and bishop to d3. Oh, black doesn't have a pawn anymore. I was gonna say, after bishop d3, well, black just puts another pawn on c4. I don't like that, because now black's got pawn advancing to e5, assuming there's nothing better. But it looks like white's got almost every square covered, so there's nowhere to place the knight with tempo. Okay, so black places the knight without tempo, just places it on g6, presumably supporting knight placed at f4, hitting the queen, trying to bring up some firepower in the vicinity of white's king. Yeah, white just develops with tempo, makes some threats, tries to scare Stockfish. I don't think that. Well, I expect what's going to happen is black is going to play bishop d7 and castle. Just get the heck out of there. It might be considering bishop e7 and castling the other direction. Although, as Zug pointed out the previous game, pawn at h6 can be strong. And none of the above. So. Black has placed all its pieces on the board. White still has two pawns to place, so some more havoc could happen here. So if you were to say white places a pawn randomly, black makes any move, and white places another pawn randomly, each pawn placement could go on one of about 30 different squares. And so. Between the two players' moves, you could have maybe one of 5,000 different positions. Maybe. I haven't exactly done the math, but if you have 30 pawn placements on a turn and 30 on the next turn, that's 900. Now, half of those are duplicates, so that's really 450. And in between, you give black a move. Black could play one of maybe about, I don't know, 30 moves, I guess. I guess in this position it's not so many. But in other chess positions you have quite a bit more. So maybe black has 20 moves to select from. So you're talking about 450 times 20. So about 9,000 positions could be reached if you're just white's randomly placing the two pawns and black's making a pseudo random move here too. So this game does branch very often in terms of just how the analysis tree looks. It's very wide and not necessarily so deep. The AI does some things that try to cleverly expand the tree both breadthwise and depthwise in the most relevant spots, but it's not. I'm not fully satisfied with where it's at the moment. I think there's still some room for improvement. Others also agree. And so I've been putting in some time trying to code and improve and tune it to play better. But yeah, algorithmically, I'm sure there's still some room for improvement. That all said, the Crazy House Computer Variant Association is running the first annual, or not, I don't even know if it's annual, but the first challenge, where they take all the strongest Crazy House engines, put them into a tournament. The conditions of this tournament are. It's a knockout event, and the top four candidates advance to the finals and play a round robin. And it's very much looking like Stockfish is going to qualify for the finals. Stockfish was the number one seed because in the pre-event exhibition, a whole bunch of Blitz games were played. And Stockfish had the best performance of all the AIs that participated in that Blitz exhibition. So I think there are three or four levels to this knockout section of the tournament. So far, Stockfish got a bye in round one. Round one, engine SJAAK, I'm not sure how to pronounce that, but we'll say Jacques, which is probably wrong. It achieved a performance of, I think, 13 wins and one loss against its opponent. So it advanced to play against Stockfish in round two. In round two, the best, I think each round's a best of 25, I'm not entirely sure, but Stockfish knocked it out 13-0. So now Jacques is playing in the loser's bracket, trying to get one of the couple wild card spots in that bracket to advance to the final four. Or the finals. So far, a number of other matches have finished. Sunsetter had quite a strong performance with winning almost all of its games. So I'm really hoping that Sunsetter also advances to the finals because thanks to Georg's, G-E-O-R-G, I forget his last name, but thanks to his efforts, we've been able to have Sunsetter do some of the analysis for chess games on Lee Chess. And thanks to his efforts, there has been substantial interest in Stockfish being able to play the variant, and that's part of why we're here today. Without Sunsetter, without Georg, or we'll say George's contributions, this might have taken much longer to happen. Hey, well, as far as today goes, mastertan and VinVin have been playing, and this is game four. I missed the first game. I was just notified right on the spot that, oh, by the way, this is happening. I got this set up to stream and commentate in time for the remaining games. I don't know how many games there will be. But yeah, Stockfish has been taking this match 3-0. And I look forward to the time when somebody points out the weakness. It's probably something subtle, but there's got to be a weakness somewhere. Has the move buffer bug been fixed? Okay, so yeah, that pawn on g2 is going to promote and then win more material, and white doesn't have a realistic attack, so white concedes that game. I was hoping something more concrete would show up on the board before the game concluded, but I guess between the time pressure and white not having a strong attack going and white's king being exposed, he just didn't feel like playing it out. I'm probably oversimplifying and that was probably dead lost, but I'm just a 2150, what do I know? Okay, so back to the question. Has the move buffer bug been fixed? The move buffer bug. I'm not entirely sure what we're referring to. For a while there was a segmentation fault, caused by Stockfish trying to access memory it didn't have permission to access. And so that was called a segmentation fault because the AI's trying to access segments of memory that are outside of its memory space. That was patched. I don't know if I'll say fixed, but it was patched. by a change to double the amount of moves that it's able to cache. So I'll say to that end, we're not experiencing segmentation faults at the moment, but it remains an open question whether or not there's still a memory leak. I haven't been able to prove or disprove it, so there could still be an issue. So far, despite valiant efforts of many developers, we still haven't figured it out. So there's a potential memory leak in there somewhere. If not a memory leak, then just a segmentation fault of sorts that doesn't result in the program immediately terminating. So maybe it's not a fault, but it's possible that Stockfish might overwrite some of the in-memory values that could be quite important to its evaluation and/or what it thinks is the best move. No, mastertan's a human. The only bot here is Stockfish being operated courtesy of Vinvin. Yeah, for sure. I've been impressed for quite a while by Sunsetter myself. I don't claim to know much about all the other AIs, but I believe the official name of this opening is that nobody plays this, says Chucklemane. I'm assuming that's like Charlemagne, but Chuckle. But yeah. No, I mean, I've seen this played. I'm not so sure about the black side of this, but I've seen e4 and d3. This is a King's Indian attack. Definitely seen this played by players who are afraid of exchanges, or players who just want to play solidly. But no, at some point I do want to automate the play of this bot so that players can choose to play against it at time controls like this. Ah, yeah, Zug must have the tennis flu. This is kind of like a King's Indian attack. Oh, I'm sorry, I forgot. Yeah, King's Indian attack typically features g3 and bishop g2. Yeah, I'm not sure what you would want to call this then, but I called it a King's Indian attack, and for in terms of Crazy House, that's probably accurate enough. No. Players do play d3 in Crazy House, it's just cowardly. It's very positional. Yeah, I'm with you, Josh, or Joshua. Yeah, Fianchetto is, it's an adventure. I would not do it in Crazy House. But yeah, I think Zug's got the tennis flu. Because he mentioned he was playing tennis the other day, and now he's thinking he has the flu. So it must be the tennis flu. I'm joking. I'm not a doctor. It is fair to disregard my medical advice, but yeah. So, at last we see D4. I'm not sure about the timing. Oh, whoa, really? Really? We're exchanging on H2 now. That was the last thing I would have guessed here. How? Why would you do that, Stockfish? Just why? I say exchanging, but that was a sacrifice. What's going on? Is this some kind of crazy house thing that I don't know about? Or is there really an initiative to be had here? Do you take on e4 and then play f5 and rook f6 or I don't know, like, how does black teleport his pieces from the queen side over to near the king? if white can get an e5 and somehow hold that pawn structure, it could be quite challenging for the knight on c6 and bishop on d7 to get anywhere. Okay, yeah, I mean, I saw queen h4 as a possibility. It just didn't seem convincing. I want something strong and crushing and convincing. Even this doesn't seem convincing. So, white plays bishop to f3. I guess I should mention some of my wins against the strongest players have featured me just avoiding piece trades and confusing my opponents. And perhaps mastertan's taking a route like that here. Not that that would work against an AI, but maybe. I mean, white could be doing bishop f3, and then if we trade on e4, the knight takes e4, and then there's a discovery on f4. Knight takes g2 threat. Okay, I guess in normal chess I would discard that, just because black doesn't have enough material to drum up a mate immediately. But knight takes g2 could be serious on account of just having the extra pawn in hand and being able to exchange and get more pawns and who knows what else in hand. But yeah, I'm not convinced. I don't understand what's going on here. Because if queen h4, just play knight at h3. Or I guess you retreat. I don't. This really doesn't feel comfortable to me to retreat like that. Maybe this is the position that Stockfish saw and it just evaluated that, oh, clearly black must be better. If so, then that's a miscalculation on Stockfish's part. Because, yeah, black's out of material to place. No, because if you trade on e2, white can get a blocker. After king h1, white can just block on h3. You don't have the same thematic mating idea that you'd have in a normal chess game. Right. If you play enough Bug House, you'll see these kind of defenses. It's surprisingly challenging to checkmate in Crazy House. I mean, White's king looks wide open, but White could always place pawns and pieces to defend against said mating ideas. So, I mean, this does look quite vulnerable, but I'm not buying it. I think that mastertan's defending quite well here. So my human intuition here would be place pawn at h2, and if black plays pawn at g3, then take it, and then place the pawn at h2 again, if you get the chance. That's just my human intuition here. Realistically, bishop at h2 might be kind of a threat in some of those positions too. Oh yeah, no, you raise a good question. Why didn't Stockfish play bishop at h2 first and then take on e4? I have no idea. Maybe it just didn't. I don't know. Maybe we found the weakness, guys. Maybe that's the weakness. Now I know there have been numerous comments on the issue tracker, but I haven't found enough test positions to prove any theories yet. Or at least my own tests trying to prove these theories have failed. Queen takes rook. Queen takes rook, GG. Because if king takes bishop, rook h4, black wins another piece, and it's just That's horrendous. You don't want to face that. And white doesn't have a mate here, so white's kind of screwed. That's unfortunate. But yeah, possibly we found a weakness in that it'll favor a move over a piece that's drop and check. Maybe it just didn't analyze bishop at h2, or maybe it just didn't see anything concrete. Maybe reserving the piece in hand is actually stronger somehow, but I doubt it. White could try knight to f3, giving up the bishop on e2, and going it for some kind of crazy all-in mating attack. I don't buy it, but he could try that. But yeah, taking on h2 seems like death. So I would probably do something other than king takes bishop. Oh, thanks for a clarification. I see a notification on Lee Chess. It's George Zimmerman is the name of the German author of Sun Setter, George Zimmerman. So thanks for the information there. Wait. So placing a knight on f3 didn't stop it. That's crazy. Wow. Oh, right. But wait, couldn't the knight have taken? I'm so confused. We'll probably see the next game soon if there is a next one, but. Oh, if knight takes g1, then queen takes knight. That's mate. Wow. That's pretty spectacular. Do you have a background in AI programming? Informally, yes. Formally, my background isn't technically in AI. It isn't in programming. It's in computer science. So there's a difference between understanding what computers are good at, and how to best, I don't know, make use of computers to solve real-world problems. There's a difference between that kind of understanding and actually being a person who has practical skill in being able to develop software. But I have a fair deal of that too. Yeah, mastertan knows that he's playing under these match conditions. There is a forum. There's a topic somewhere. Vin Vin is trying to solicit interest from top Crazy House players on the site in playing it under such conditions. And so far, we've had Jan Lee very graciously volunteer. Really glad to have him participating. And not only is he playing, but he's commentating as he plays. I don't know how he does it, because it's quite the challenge. And then, very recently, as of right now, mastertan has been playing some games as well. And these have been fantastic. Am I missing a game? No, I'm not. Just want to make sure. Oh, any good video for a new player? For normal chess? Yeah. MC's probably right. Chess Network is quite good. Also, I mean, it's a lot of fun to learn on your own, but if possible, try to join up with players in real life to see if there's anybody playing chess in your area. Some areas have more chess players than others, so that might be easier for some than for others. But it's more fun playing with people, and people at least people who play in tournaments from time to time can encourage you as to how to best improve and point out what you're doing right and wrong. But yeah, if you want to learn on your own, yeah, those kind of video series can be good. I haven't in a while helped with that sort of training for new players, though I did used to teach a summer class. That was good fun too. Yeah, it's definitely nice of them to run the engine through its paces. So I've been mousing over the players' names just to see whether the match is ongoing or whether they're taking a break or possibly done. I honestly don't know, but if they're playing more, I don't want to miss it. If they're done, it's been quite a fun match. So I think I have this set to play. Yeah, I'm following Master Tan's games, even though it doesn't say Master Tan TV over here. We are indeed following his games, so if he does play another one, we'll be following that as well. But it's seeming like they've hit kind of either a break or a conclusion. These games did run on for quite a while, so it's possible we might be done. I'm not sure. To MC's question, I am one of the authors of this particular part of the engine. It's some pretty gracious contributions from Fabian Fichter. He did the initial Crazy House implementation. I only did some very primitive things, such as trying to define the input format and output format for representing a position and representing a move. And I was quite skeptical that this could be done in Stockfish. Fabian proved me wrong that this was doable. And then after he proved me wrong and showed me that this could actually be done, well, a few weeks later we finally fixed the segmentation faults. So the program would not crash every second or third or however many game, but it would continue playing. So that was a good thing. But in the interim, after he submitted his changes, there were numerous bug reports because it wasn't perfect immediately, and I completely understand that. And I was really glad and grateful for what Fabian contributed. But no, I committed the better part of a weekend trying to fix the move generator, so it would only generate legal moves. It would only generate the subset of legal moves that we're interested in. For example, if we have a position like this, some moves like checks and captures take higher precedence than other moves. And so I rewrote the move generator to optimally generate drops first and then captures and checks and quiet moves that run out of check and all the various permutations. So I rewrote the move generator. But the rest of this was largely Fabian's effort. Oh, okay. Thanks for running this, Vin Vin. It's been a lot of fun. But yeah, after rewriting the move generator, then we fixed the bug so it wouldn't crash very frequently. There's still 19 open issues in the issue tracker, so there's still quite a bit to be done. I'm still working on trying to get around to every one of those things that's there. At the same time, I'm trying to make best use of some testing and tuning tools, so just to improve our best practices with testing and development. Yeah, I'm not sure. One bug, at least in my mind, was that, like, positions like this one, it has the option to capture here or to place the bishop on h2. A human, 9 times out of 10, would play the check here, but maybe taking here is more flexible and better. I'm not sure. This has been something you've been saying for a while. And just the more test positions I come up with, the more I'm able to test with this sort of thing. But it also takes some effort to parse every one of the games and extract every test position, so there's a lot of manual effort there too. Stockfish overpassed the time limit when looking for lines and checkmates. Yeah, in fact, there's a bug in the official Stockfish that my Stockfish is forked from, where it doesn't reliably return on time every time. And so I set it to always play with a move overhead of 1 second or 1,000 milliseconds, just so it can budget its time accordingly. But I do want to try to automate play of this AI, so players can play against it. Not necessarily require a manual operator to decide when the engine's ready to move each time. But yeah, this could potentially be an issue to worry about. I did say at some point I'm gonna try a Stockfish challenge. It'll be fun when I do attempt it. Although I don't expect to be anywhere near as successful as mastertan, I probably would lose much more rapidly than he did. Okay, Stockfish does prefer to take the pawn. Still, I don't know. I don't. It's unclear to me, because to me, putting the bishop on h2 seems strong, but maybe it's not best. Only because, like, if I take on e4, white has the ability to just place the pawn. Oh, I can't do it in this mode. I have to go to the analysis board. But white could just place the pawn on h2. And yeah, okay, you get some interesting tactics and complications there, but why even bother? It's not like anything can attack the queen, so there's no reason not to check here first and then take. Because I guess the only thing that could attack the queen would be, well, what actually happened in the game was this. So with the bishop on h2 and king on h1, I'd still prefer black's position, but really the instinctive thing to do for black here would be to check and then pull the bishop back to f4, undiscovering the attack on the queen. I mean, admittedly, that does pin the bishop, but I don't know. Or it stops playing in a classical game if moves are made. Oh, yeah. That's really a shame. Unfortunately, I don't know if I can do anything about that. I could attempt to duplicate that on my Lee Chess copy or instance. Just repeatedly restart the site and see if I can find a way to fix that. But that's problematic. Yeah, I don't know that I trust the engine evaluation either. I mean, yeah, we can go here and see whether it thinks that bishop at h2 was any better than just taking e4. You're saying that that's only plus 1.3. I mean, the only evaluation I really trust out of the engine at this point, just given how new this engine is, the only evaluation I trust is a mate evaluation. Crazy House is just complicated enough that getting the evaluation function to be accurate in every position is challenging, honestly. And I mean, yeah, I'm playing here with local Stockfish, which isn't exactly the same either. But to me, this seems like the obvious move. I mean, sure, when black does withdraw the bishop, white will get a tempo to block here somehow, but I don't know. It's surprising to me that you wouldn't want to prevent white from placing the pawn on h2. You'd have to evaluate it out to mate to prove me right, or evaluate out pawn takes e4 to mate to prove me wrong. But yeah, I don't know. That just seems really strange to me.